So my name's Dominic Campbell. I'm co-founder of Creative Aging International, and so I spend quite a lot of time thinking and working with changing and aging demographics and all that that means. And so I'm delighted to welcome all of you here this evening to look at one of the very specific things, which is this growing area of arts and dementia, creative practice.
I'm David Savill, and I'm the artistic director of the charity Age Exchange. I don't know if you know a great deal about Age Exchange. We're about 32 years old, and we specialize in what we would call reminiscence work, or what today we usually call reminiscence arts practice, which I'll talk a little bit about later on. We use reminiscence very much in terms of exploring identity, story, humanity, commonality, and then I suppose giving those stories expression through creativity. I think reminiscence, I don't want to jump the gun here, but is quite often seen in quite conventional terms. So maybe we see it very much as a narrative, and the ability to tell a story. And certainly when I started practicing and made my very first mistake in 1998, expecting a lady with dementia to be able to understand my narrative, we've come a long way since then. So really, I'd like to, when I talk about reminiscence, I'd like us to think about it maybe without language or with language, maybe as a sensory experience, and I mean all the senses, and particularly through body and embodied memory, which has very much been part of the development of our organization. So Age Exchange, yes, we work in the arts, but the primary purpose of our charity is to raise the profile of vulnerable people in British society and to find ways of giving them a voice or of supporting them. That's what we exist for. And we work a lot in care homes, in residential care. We work with the NHS, with local authority, and with private care providers. And we're trying to extend our services as we see services around us disappearing rapidly. And we have enormous concerns, actually. I mean, I think it's a bit like talking about Holland. There's about five of us and 32 freelancers all collectively putting our finger in the dike and waiting for the dam to burst. And that's what it feels like, really.
My name's Molly Bretton, and I'm the Access Manager at the Royal Academy of Arts. I manage a broad programme of creative learning events for disabled audiences and people at risk of exclusion from the arts, specifically in relationship to this evening's conversation. I manage a monthly program for people experiencing dementia that's been going about 6 years. I work with four artist educators to do that, and they are multi-sensory conversational sessions looking at and experiencing works from our permanent collections. I have a personal interest in creative interventions for people experiencing dementia. My granddad had Lewy bodies, and unfortunately he experienced that before I entered this world of knowing more about creative engagement. So I'm here this evening to probably learn as much as I am to talk about my experiences in the work that I do at the RA.
Bisakha Sarker is, sorry, I need the video mic, is artistic director of Chaturangan. It's a Liverpool-based company engaged in creative activities to raise the profile of South Asian dance. And we asked her for a couple of observations and provocations, really. One of the pieces of work that she's been working on is called Dancing Moments. It's a creative South Asian dance resource to re-energize and re-inspire people in the early stages of dementia.
I'm Bisakha Sarker. I'm an artist, and I work in all different situations, and they're all special to me. And one of the area is to work with people living with dementia and their friends and family and carers. You know, I don't mind telling what my age is. I'm comfortable with that. But I don't want to start with that. If people want to see my work, they should see it as a work by an experienced artist, not whatever age I am. I wanted to people to accept me for what I do, not how many years I have lived in the world. Things that has changed is my choice of content has radically changed, I think. What I want to dance, what I love to dance, are things which connect more deeply with me. Not just the kind of, you know, expressing the same feelings but through different mediums, sort of. Yeah, I think I like to work with the present because there are a few problems of working mostly with the past as an Indian dancer, as somebody coming from culturally diverse art forms. Because sometimes people who come to work with me, I do not share their past, or I'm not a part of their past. So if we isolate work like that we are going to base most of the things with the past that people can remember, then that completely takes all the experience that we can share out of that equation. Whereas if I take people as where they are, then what it means is that I'm definitely sharing my present with these people. We are also sharing our future. So if I can build it there, then we can really share the whole wealth of culturally diverse resources that we have. And if we bring different culturally diverse things, it does both of them. You see something new and different, and that kind of stirs your attention. And then again, maybe momentarily, but the engagement of the mind happens. And I think unless we create more work with the now, as the person is now and here, then we will miss out on a lot of important work that we have done throughout 70s and 80s on cultural integration, which is so important because worldwide we live in a very culturally diverse world.
One of the things I really enjoy when I listen to Bisakha is that I know she's a performer, I know she's a choreographer, I know she's a researcher and an educationist, and one of her jobs as a researcher was that she was a senior research fellow on the Anthropological Survey of India. And so in a way, within her lifetime, she's been what sometimes we tend to think of as a bit of a divide in terms of research and in terms of creative practice. It's kind of interesting place.
So my name's Arti Prashar, and I am currently the artistic director of Spare Tyre. I've been with the company now since 2000, actually, but took over running the company in 2006. So we say we work with a lot of disadvantaged adults, and they come under the categories of adults with learning disabilities, women who've experienced violence, older people, and people who are living with dementia, and also economically disadvantaged communities. So that's a lot of the world that we are kind of working and running projects with. But one of the areas that we got very involved with recently because of our work with older people is looking at how we could work with dementia in a more creative way. A few years ago, we were running regular workshops, you know, drama workshops, and actually they were not benefiting people who had dementia. The things that we were trying to do with them was really quite appalling, if I may say so myself. So we kind of put a kind of a bit of a halt to it and stepped back away from it and started researching and looking around to see whether we actually wanted to go further in that field or whether we were going to just walk away from that field. And actually what kept me in the field was when I heard over and over again at that time, so it's been a few years now, a lot of care staff turning around to me and saying, I don't know how to communicate with them. And I just thought, but this is another human being. What exactly is stopping you communicating with them?
So, Arti, let's start with you. Okay. You were suggesting that in the work that you were doing, you got to the point where you might have stopped, and you didn't because... the pullback was what? The feedback was coming from where?
So very much from kind of the community centres that we go into and places like that. People were just saying that they just didn't know how to communicate with someone who has dementia or is living with dementia. And I just find that extraordinarily difficult because actually, I suppose it's also a very cultural, actually, it comes from a very cultural perspective because actually I've grown up in the UK where people haven't particularly made an effort to learn about me and my culture, and I've had to do it. I've had to learn about the host community and therefore find pathways of how I could negotiate it. So it kind of works in that way. So I just go, actually, you just need to stop and find out what languages people are speaking, languages in the broadest sense, you know, the non-verbal, the cultural, the religious, all of those languages. And actually then, because we're talking about basic human connection, that's what we're talking about, after all. And it's always about the context, isn't it, then? Then I think it's about putting people in a certain context as to how we can kind of start that communication going or making it a bit more better, a bit more creative. And I think that's really what kept me and has kept me in this area, actually, because now the work is, I would have to say, it is very much moving into kind of looking at cultural and spiritual needs now of the people that I'm working with.
Molly, you work in quite a different context. So whereas David and Arti would have a company, a producing company of sorts, you work within an extraordinary gallery within a 600-year-old history. Mm. So explain how your work, particularly the work with dementia, fits within their aspirations and what it is that's happening and how that works in terms of communication, really.
So yeah, you're right. The Royal Academy is an extraordinary place to be working. We're almost 250 years old. We're managed by artists in the same way that we were when we were established by a society of artists in 1768. The aspirations at the beginning of starting in mind, which is the session that we run for people experiencing dementia, is very similar to our reasons for running it now, which is that the Royal Academy has an older demographic than other comparable arts institutions. And in looking at that, and in the hope of ensuring that the Royal Academy is somewhere that people can, we have a fantastic early years program, work with schools, we work with families. We wanted to ensure that people can continue coming to the Royal Academy to its exhibitions, enjoying its architecture and its collections throughout the whole of their lives. And what we realized is that there were a certain audience that were stopping coming, either because they were someone who was experiencing dementia or they were a carer of someone experiencing dementia, and that they didn't feel like just coming to the galleries and having a self-directed trip was meeting their needs. So we started to look around and think about how we could meet that need and take away that barrier. And we found the Meet Me at MoMA model, which is the MoMA in New York. And we really liked what they were doing there, the research that that they were undertaking there, and we began a conversation. And we started in mind as a pilot with a year to see how it would go and see what we'd learn. And it was popular. We found it worked well, given the expertise that we have in terms of engaging people in creative ways of looking at art and talking about art. And we also embedded some of the experience that we had from working with children with special educational needs in terms of our multisensory approaches to engaging in a nonverbal way. And so we mixed some of our experience there, and then it really has just been a learning process. And we continue to learn and talk about the sessions that we've undertaken. People, how they're responding, and yeah, it's ever growing. And at the moment, the conversational multisensory sessions are pitched, we talk about them as being appropriate for people in early to mid-stage dementia, and we are working on trying to develop a model of engagement in collaboration with Nightingale House, a care home. We're spending some time with them looking at their models of engagement to try and grow our confidence in working with people in later stages.
David, I'm going to come to you because, so Age Exchange, was it 30 years old?
Yeah.
Yeah, way back in sort of 1987 or 8 or something, and I went and did a first workshop with them, which was one of my introductions to when I was watching the Wayne Short Trousers, obviously. And it was fascinating because one of the things that they did was have a conversation about arts work, about creative processes, absolutely alongside what the understanding was scientifically at the time. And so that wasn't, that was the starting point. The starting point was this is the ground that we will now build on. And so I'm partly interested in, as an organisation, what influences you've kept alive within the work that you do, but also the way that when you started talking and said, you know, you started off yourself by making a small mistake.
Yeah. A big mistake.
Big mistake. Tell us about the big mistake.
A big mistake. Well, I come from I came to London from Exmoor. That's a journey. In about 1984, and I came to train at the Drama Centre with some quite remarkable people then. Mike Lee taught us improvisation, and that was scary. And the great Yap Malgram taught us movement psychology and Laban technique. Yes, it was quite an extraordinary training. And I was always really interested in living memory. I was always really interested in this idea of the arts being exclusive for certain people. And actually, I'm a deeply political person, for which I make no apologies. And that just wasn't acceptable to me. And as the 80s went on and became as horrible as the 80s became, I started to go in a very particular direction, which was about wanting to make art, theatre in my case, with people in order to help them tell their story. So I eventually ended up at Age Exchange with Pam Schweitzer, and in 1998 I was sent to run my first project at a care home in Bournemouth. The idea was we were going to create Reminiscence Theatre with a group of 16 older people. Some of them were close to 100, so they were Victorians, which was quite an experience to work with Victorians. Special experience. And there was a lady in the group who didn't talk, and I knew she had dementia. And we worked there for about, it must have been 4 or 5 weeks, and I had my reminiscence boxes, my thematic boxes, I had all the things I was doing, I was very prepared, there were three of us, there was me, two visual artists, and everyone was very engaged in sharing stories and narratives and so on, and this lady was locked out. So after the, I don't know, sixth session, I met her daughter, and her daughter said, "Oh, is Mum coming along?" And she said, "You probably don't know anything about her. Does she say anything?" "No. She doesn't actually know her name. We knew she was called Minnie." And it turned out that her mum had been a music hall star in the 1920s with her twin sister and a singer. And I had not done one single thing that made it possible for her to take part on her terms. Nothing. I hadn't done any homework on her, nothing on her background. My approach to her wasn't at all person-centered. It was all about me as an artist going in and expecting her to respond to the wonderful things that I had taken from my training for her to benefit from. So then we were so freaked out by our own stupidity. We went away and we did our homework on the history of the Sheffield, Leeds, and Yorkshire musical scene in the 1920s, and we took in as much music as we could. We also took in a live musician. We went to the next session, and we began, and absolutely stunning was that she began to sing. And this woman couldn't speak, actually. She couldn't actually complete a sentence, but she could remember every song she had ever sung, and she could communicate through singing, And what was really astonishing, which actually became part of the piece of theatre we put together, was that when other women in the group shared a memory or an experience, Minnie would find the right song that reflected the emotion within that memory. You know, whether that was Roses of Picardy or whatever it was. And so that was her means of communicating. And I think it was just that whole sort of awful wake-up moment of just thinking, you know, I expected her to, you know, understand the concept of time, the concept of narrative, you know, all as opposed to finding other ways of communicate, which were actually, when she communicated with the level of emotional intelligence which remained within her heart, you know, she was way above us. She was somewhere way away from us. Sorry, long answer.
No, great answer, fantastic answer. And it kind of makes me want to ask you two about those moments where you go, oh, that's working, and what they look like. The ones where you go, that's Arti.
I guess when we first started doing this, went down the road of kind of using a storytelling format. It was extraordinarily multisensory still, because actually, I took a lot of learning from having worked with adults with learning disabilities into the dementia work. So that's kind of my journey in the kind of way that I've been working. But one of the things that happened was that as we were doing that program, and we started off with people who were at early onset, in the middle, and then we discovered that this first project, which was Once Upon a Time, as a piece about an old woman and her three sons and heritage and inheritance, actually, it was actually not getting through to kind of two-thirds of the spectrum. But actually it was extraordinary, working really well with those on the advanced dementia scale. So we kept it there and we focused it there in the multisensory area. And having finished that, then I decided actually one of the things that we have to do is become nonverbal. And I think that's the journey we are now down. And we have become totally nonverbal. As I was making those kind of noises that we are going to become totally nonverbal, I think people were... Or some of my colleagues were going, "Are you nuts?" Frankly, we can't go totally non-verbal after having been very verbal. But actually, it has been absolutely the right way to go, because actually, it's just working extraordinarily well for everybody, not just those with dementia, but for everybody to create that environment.
Explain what you mean by everybody.
So, by everybody, it's we're working. So it's working across the dementia spectrum, which I was still kind of not sure about, but it certainly is. So from early onset to the advanced, it's working really well for paid and family carers. It's working, I think, for just regular people, if I may put it in that way, as well. So that's been an unexpected outcome, really. And having said that, though, this morning... We had a tricky session where we had a lot of older people who are very intellectual, and they found it quite difficult. They weren't quite sure, because they probably knew it was designed for someone with dementia. I'm not sure they wanted to engage with it. It made them feel uncomfortable. Maybe it was like reflecting their mortality or their pathways too much for them. So that's another interesting area.
A main standout moment was with a gentleman who had been coming. He had been a criminal barrister and was diagnosed very early, kind of in his late 50s. And his partner, who he came with, was in their first few sessions was very concerned about them both within the session, and they had seemed quite anxious and, you know, would sit to the back, and the gentleman would very rarely say anything. And in our third session with him, we gave everyone a piece of paper and a piece of graphite, and without any specific task, just said, as we're exploring this work, if you want to draw something, write something, respond in a visual way, then you can do. And, you know, he shrugged his shoulders, and we thought, well, unlikely that he'll engage with that. And when Jackie got home with him, she was going through his coat pockets and found the piece of paper and saw that he had actually worked on it. She put it back in his pocket, and then a few days later saw that he'd got it back out and he was working back into it. And essentially that was the beginning of Tony's art career. He identifies as an artist now, and he comes to every monthly session, and that's how he chooses to introduce himself. And we've exhibited his work at several different events now, and I'd like to think that he would have found his creative path anyway, but he'd never done art before. He used to say that, and now Jackie, repeats that, that he enjoyed looking at art, but he'd never made anything, and that was his start. So I think for me that's a standout moment.
Yeah. What is it that you're currently learning from the people that you're working with? That's okay.
I'll share something. This is I think it's very interesting, because there is a I've worked in what we would call reminiscence work now since 1998, and certainly how I see it now is a very long way away from perhaps how I saw it as an actor originally. And I see it very much as being a very valuable tool within care, and particularly my greatest, I don't know how it's happened, don't know why it's happened, but my greatest sort of thing in my head now, for as long as I stay at Age Exchange, is about what we can do to alter hearts and minds and to alter caring environments, specifically within residential care. And that's a lot of our work now is in that world. And probably because I would keep plopping in and running yet another project in a residential care home and plopping out, and then going off to another one and going in once a week and actually seeing that you were really quite privileged going in once a week, because you weren't. It was a bit like the night I spent last night at North Middlesex Hospital and just thinking, my God, you know, how do people do this 24/7? This is really difficult. Yeah. And it's all right for me as an artist to go in and think, let's do something valuable for that hour, but what could we actually do to use reminiscence arts, as we call it, to actually affect change in some small way. And in some ways, that's not working. In other ways, it is. We've just finished a big three-year trial funded by guys in St. Thomas's called Radical, Reminiscence Arts and Dementia, Impact on Quality of Life. And that was working in 12 units for 2 years. I think it's over about 380-something reminiscence sessions, one-to-ones, working with multidisciplinary artists trained in reminiscence work, trained in dementia care, and looking at how, over time, their work could actually improve levels of well-being for participants and residents, but also how it could affect the environment. I'm happy if anybody wants it, it's here. I've just realized that the typeprint is so small I can't read it. That might be a good thing. But if you want it, you can see it. It was evaluated by Royal Holloway, University of London, and so on. So that's there. But I kind of think that I'm probably unhealthily obsessed with the past. The past has probably played a huge part in my life. I was partly brought up by my grandmother, by my grandparents. I'm one of those strange schizoid families which has a lot of kind of bit of dark history and sadness and so on. And it is very strange because one of the teachers I have at the moment, I'm seeing tomorrow, Hannah Kirscher. Hannah Kirscher is an artist who works for the Dachau Institute, right next to where Dachau concentration camp was. Her father was an SS officer and a murderer. Her grandfather was in the Prussian army in the First World War. And she sees her work as an artist being entirely about atonement, and her work being about how she can wipe away the past and bring something beautiful to the future. So the past has lots of different layers, you know, it's complex.
Marty, what are you learning?
What am I learning? at the moment? I think I'm learning a bit more of Arti's world of things. I'm learning a bit more about non-verbal methods of engagement. I'm also learning that what we're doing is never enough. You greeted me this evening and said, "Oh, managing a program that's consistently sold out," and you'd think that that would be something that I'm happy with. It's not. It's something that keeps me awake at night. The fact that I run a monthly program and at the moment, for various different reasons, I can't deliver any more. And I could fill those sessions four times over. And I don't know where else those people are going when they can't get in through our doors. And that really concerns me. So I think that's what I'm learning as well. Is a deep, deep concern that what we're doing is good, but it's
the demand is ever increasing.
It is. Yeah. It is.
So what am I learning? I'm learning. It's actually, Dominic, it's a more profound question than we think. It sounds very simple, but actually what I'm learning is actually I do not want to be in a care home when I get older. That's one of the things that I'm learning. I would love to change the culture and the environment. I think it's going to be a really tough uphill struggle to do it, to change hearts and minds. That's what I'm saying. That's not to say that I will stop. But that's one of the things that I am beginning to learn, that I definitely do not want to be in one of those environments. And it's also making me consider my own mortality. It's making me consider my own end of life. And it's making me consider my life in a very spiritual lens. And so what it's done is that it's made me reflect on my own cultural and religious well-being and how that has been influencing my life. So it's also made me think, actually, how would that influence other people's lives at the end of their lives. And I know that increasingly, I certainly have, I'm not a practicing Hindu anymore, but actually every ounce of me has been conditioned or influenced by that upbringing. So that's the kind of learning I think I'm going through at the moment. I'm also not big on my past because I think I've always felt from being 5 years old that my happiness was snatched from me when we were forced to leave East Africa. And I think that's partly why I do here and now and present as well, and being with people in the present, because I just don't know what's going to happen next. I don't know whether it's going to be good or bad. And I think, so this is me analyzing this right now, here and now. But I think that's kind of what I'm learning. You know, that's what I'm learning. Where it's going to take me, I'm not sure yet. But that's certainly been some of the learning things.
It's good to do the learning halfway through the conversation. I am very aware that we are incredibly privileged sitting here, and we're talking about learning with a group of people rather than just sitting here. So just so that I know that I'm on the right sort of track with the questioning, I want you to just to take three questions in a row or four questions in a row of the things that you're thinking about before we carry on any longer and you get bewildered by information. So I'm just wondering if there's anybody out there in the far side of the lights, if you've got a question or an observation that you might want to throw in at this point, and I'll take two or three in a row just so I can shape the conversation around them. What's anybody? Yes, please.
Yeah, I'd just like to make the observation that I think you're really brave and honest, all of you, to have said that you realise you've made presumptions about dementia and how those people might feel or how to work with them. And I just wanted to say that I just thought it was really great and really honest that you've all said that in a different way.
Okay. So, bravery and honesty. And anybody? Yes, please.
I'd love to hear more about the impact on the wider than just the individual with dementia. You've all referred to that. And I'd love to just hear more about the staff, the fact that you work with partners as well. That seems like a very important part of the work. I'd just love to hear a bit more.
Okay, I'm going to take another few. because I can sense they might be out there bubbling away.
I just might go with it. Something that Arti mentioned about your session with regular people. Mm. Just like, who are these people and how did they get into your session? Where are you? What was your setting, basically?
Who are regular people?
That's why they were in inverted commas.
Any more out there floating around? Yes, please. I'll take all of them. Just going to keep coming.
With looking at reminiscent stuff, if it doesn't follow the structure of a narrative, what structure does it follow?
Ah, great question. If reminiscence doesn't follow structure and narrative, what does it follow? Fab question. Yeah. Anybody else? Please.
It was just responding to Arti saying that it, you know, the non-verbal communication works well for everybody. It's something that I would absolutely agree with. And just thinking more about the whole life course and how it connects and about creativity and play rather than focusing just on it's something for children and then it sort of gets discarded for the rest of your life unless you have children and grandchildren and maybe get to play again with them. But how do we begin to introduce playfulness and allow adults that free expression to play so that perhaps if you are unfortunate to get dementia or another condition when you become older, that it's not so foreign to begin to engage you non-verbally?
Beautiful, beautiful question. Yes?
I'm very interested in intensive interaction because when I was earlier in my career, I worked with children with a learning disability. And I can see quite a lot of potential using intensive interaction and wonder whether that was the theories behind that you could also...
Explain a little bit more.
There was some... The basic idea is that you spend time with someone but you're led by them so that you're not doing anything until they do something.
Yeah.
And then you're trying to mirror what they do so that they have an opportunity to lead the conversation rather than you doing to them.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just keep them coming, it's okay. Go on, we'll stay here for a bit, it's good.
The lovely point about play, I think a lot of people with dementia are extremely playful. Experiences people have of their relatives being anxious and concerned about an infantilization of their adult relative.
Yeah.
And other people have got experience of that. Dementia dolls, for example, or just using play because there is such an adult perception of play as being a childish or childlike thing to do.
Yeah, go on.
Can I? I'm a drama therapist and I work on an acute dementia ward in an NHS setting, and only yesterday one of the patients with acute dementia said, "This is childish." And I'm constantly trying to work out this difference between childlike and childish. Mm. And in fact, she ended up the session taking literally centre stage and just loving it. But and often it's with relatives who think, because we play, we have balloons, we have sensory things, and they think we're just playing. But it's not. It's actually, it goes right underneath.
And by acute ward, you mean it's locked?
Yes.
It's a secure ward? Okay. Rona?
I was involved in an intergenerational project, and a lot of the children involved were either preschool or sort of primary age, and we had some people from Age UK who were service users, so they were in their 70s, 80s, 90s. And the person who was actually facilitating the project, I was the co-facilitator assistant person, but a lot of the project was kind of just aimed at that sort of sense of shared mutual play. And I thought a lot of the activities, a lot of the songs that were being used were very sort of childish sort of songs.
Yeah.
And a lot of the older people felt disengaged, and no matter what I said, you know, I said, why don't we do some of the older sort of songs to kind of like, you know, teach the young kids side by side and by the Blackbird, and even more recent older songs like Dean Martin and Frank Sinatra songs. But that wasn't actually taken into account, that I felt really frustrated that we sort of kept in that sort of childlike level. And the projects that I actually run, I don't run them like that, I run them very differently. So.
Okay. There's one more over there, and then I'm going
to... Sorry, because I've asked one before. Playing on that play.
We're not counting.
It's just the relationship. I work specifically in music.
Yeah.
And I'm aware that I'd really love to hear more about that, the role of music within your work.
So, great. So now you're in the conversation too. Ha ha. there are all sorts of places we could start. I think I'm gonna do a context one actually first. So, what is unique about art making in old age? There are probably four things. One is the relationship between an artist and an audience with whom you are both aged. That's sort of secondary for this conversation, but the other three are probably kind of relevant to this. So the first one is you've always been an artist. You always painted, you always sang, you just got older. You just keep making stuff. You've done it for an increasingly long time. The second one is that you have always been an artist. You've always made stuff, whatever that stuff is. I don't really care at all. But your circumstances in some way change. So you could be a 25-year-old ballerina. You could be the lead violinist of the Berlin Philharmonic who becomes arthritic. You could be, for the purposes of this, a actor who, when he gets to the side of the stage, isn't quite certain that he knows or she knows the lines when they step into the spotlight. You could be living with loss in all sorts of different ways. Or you could be a person who, for all sorts of reasons, and regardless of whatever your cognitive processes are, come to an engagement with your own creativity. And some of those people are the people that rock up in your projects. They come to an engagement with their own creativity because they meet you for the first time. And so I think that it's worth keeping that in mind. And one of the things that's popping up in this really is about that awkwardness of you know, learning to play as an adult. And so what strikes me is the contextual game is actually about, it's like the social definition of disability. So it's not necessarily that, it might be that we're the problem, if you see what I mean. And I'm just wondering how that manifests itself in what you do.
I was just
going to
say we are the problem.
Yeah. No, we're not. No, we're not. Oh, I don't think we're the problem. I find actually what you know, if you ask me what still keeps me, what joy I get out of doing this kind of work, is that I love inhibition. I absolutely love it when it's unpredictable. And that's what keeps me there. I know it makes actually perhaps family, relatives, loved ones a little bit nervous sometimes because of that inhibition that's happening. And I love the fact that actually we are working with a new character, a new person, what I call a new person being born. So that's what I kind of really get a kick out of actually. And within that, because my mischievousness comes out. That's really what happens. My naughtiness absolutely comes out in situations like that. And I will just play with them. So as you were describing, because a lot of my learning that I have taken into this area of work comes from working with adults, with being led by them, mirroring them and going into their world rather than asking them to come into my world. That's the kind of way that I think I'm practicing still. So I love all of that. So, and I love that, and from that interaction that comes on whatever level, wherever it is, however it is, how rude, angry, sexy, noisy it gets, that's what I like.
So I'd just say, is roughly an answer to that you, a couple of issues. One was, I think you raised a very good issue about reminiscence itself, which is something that I feel I should answer. The other was about music. I remember I had a girlfriend. I did have one girlfriend, and she, hopefully more. But I always remember she was so snooty. I was Devonian, she was Cornish. We've always had a problem with that. And I remember she said, you know, that you're going to be an actor. That is the lowest of the art forms. You know, she was a musician and you know, her mother was an artist, you know. And actually, sometimes I think maybe she was right, because it's words just really often are not enough, and they do often complicate things. And reminiscence, and the value of reminiscence with people with dementia, is often in knowing more about their story through their carer, through their wife or through their husband. It's actually having the backstory to the person who perhaps cannot supply that story. It's having a background so that you provide more appropriate care, more appropriate support by knowing things about that person. I'll give a really blisteringly awful example in a way. A home, I can't name the home, but it's in South London. And there was a man who was extremely distressed, almost all the time distressed. We were going in twice a week to do one-to-one sessions and group work. And I have one of my team who's in his late 60s and he's a terrifically empathetic, beautiful person. And he would follow this man around as he was getting more and more distressed, and he would wander. And obviously there's a thing about wandering into other people's rooms, which you're not supposed to do. And he was always in his pockets, always kind of looking for things in his pockets and things. And eventually it came to light that this man had been a locksmith. And that he thought that he, well, we, did he think? I don't know, but his job was to go to the rooms and make sure everything was secure and everything was right. But actually, it just presented itself without the ability to have language as, you know, destructive. What's the word that's used about people with dementia sometimes? Challenging behaviours. Isn't that beautiful? An Orwellian phrase, that is. Challenging behaviours. And so Tony, being Tony, goes down, I can't remember if it was Deptford, it was either Deptford or which market, buys a whole load of locks, keys, the works, takes them in a sack, spreads them out in the man's room, and the man fills his pockets with the keys and the things, and over time becomes less distressed and still today has crammed full pockets, you know. And yes, okay, that's not necessarily reminiscence as a narrative. That's just finding something very, very simple about a person who feels safer and more secure just having that, you know, with him. And very similar stories about music as well. I could relate, but I won't. But, you know, about people who can't communicate verbally. But so in this case, it's a guy who used to play the drums, a home in West London, quite aggressive behaviour, and actually spent time with one of our musicians who just would go in and play drums. And then gradually over time, this guy would mirror and respond, you know, and it's just literally fine. We call it, it's like being a detective. There's no mystery to reminiscence work whatsoever. Sorry, that's just it.
No, it's okay. And it leads on quite nicely to that great question about narrative. So I'm going to ask you first about it, because in a way your work's visual, or the processes you engage with are visual. And where does narrative come into that? So is it because people are interpreting and they're building?
Yeah, so it starts with the selection of an artwork, which is guided by participants. So we make them vote in the same way as our Royal Academicians vote on the summer exhibition entries and on electing RAs into the RA fold, which is with little kind of wooden ballots. We use wooden spoons. And so they choose which works they want to be looking at in the coming months. We then kind of work through them. So it begins with, I have two artist educators that work on one work in each session. So there are two rooms, two pieces of work, and two people working on each one of those. One of them is specifically looking at what the work is, who the artist is, narratives that they can pull out surrounding that, thinking about questions that might come up, questions that might draw conversation, discussion, dissent. And then the other person is looking at multi-sensory avenues in and around that artwork. So sometimes it's music. Sometimes we cook things. Sometimes it's smells. Sometimes it's clothing, textures. Anything we can think of that might be the route in to engaging with the conversation or just the session in a way that seems meaningful to them. So I guess that answers your question.
Brilliant.
Yeah, that's
it's,
yeah.
So it's sort of back to this thing that that narrative is uncovered. It's like archaeology. And is that, David, is that reminiscence? Is the reminiscence partly that? It's not necessarily what did you do in 1941, grandmother?
I don't think, and you know, it's too late to do anything about the word, but because it would be the end of our funding. God, what have I become? But it is quite a difficult word. And actually, my sister, thankfully she's bilingual, and I've got to do this speech in German tomorrow. And the word for reminiscence, I think it's 14 letters. It's about nine syllables. And you think if it's not even a helpful, I can't know, don't even ask. It's like, you know. But it's not a helpful word. But then I've always felt more at home with it than its sister, which is oral history. I've never been very happy with oral history. We don't, you know, it's a terrible analogy, but a lot of the work that we've done was kind of thematic stuff, so I've done a lot of work with veterans, and we've done Holocaust Project, big Holocaust Project with Lodz. I always see reminiscence as being primarily about the person and then the story, as opposed to the story and then the person, if that makes sense. But in terms of narrative, we do still work a lot with narrative. We do work with people who are able to share their story and want to share their story. We're running four projects now at Age Exchange, which are for people with dementia and their carers. So that's three days a week. And on the fourth day, we run what's called the Kaleidoscope Cafe, which is for people with young onset dementia and their carers. And some of the carers, the youngest carer is 20, and the oldest carer is 30-something, and their parents are kind of in their like mid-40s. But they want to share the story of mum or dad. So quite often you're getting a very, very full life story narrative coming from the carer, who wants you to know as much as you possibly can about the person who's with them, who they feel can't share their story. I also think in terms of a narrative, I don't think there's anything wrong with just a bit or a fragment. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Maybe it's a British thing, but we kind of seem to be quite obsessed sometimes about everything being complete, you know, everything being sort of linear. And certainly I found it very interesting working with people who can't complete a narrative but want to share a fragment. And I was very involved last year with this big First World War thing, which I was very surprised by. We worked right across London, 108 hours of interviews with the public who brought father's story, mother's story. They were second generation mostly, so we're talking very old people who were born, you know, just after the First World War in 1920-something. And I was really shocked by their desire to share a fragment. And sometimes it was just a fragment through an object, or it was a fragment of a memory that had been passed down to them. And you have to make sure in our work that you give as much resonance and audience or whatever to that fragment as if they were sharing a whole story. I think that's really important.
It's there's somebody that I work with who's Nigerian, West Nigerian, and the way that they talk about memory and the way that they talk about story is very different. In the sense of what they say is that a story is made by all of us assembling. We all bring fragments of story. And it's only by sitting in the room that you this starts to link up. Spent more than half of my life living in the Irish Republic, and in the rural parts of that, that's how an evening works. I come along and have a bit of a story. In fact, I really need a full story, but I'll only have a bit of the whole story. And the whole story is the where we are. The Mike White, the what would he be now? He would have passed away. He would have passed from the living. The academic, the guy that wrote A Social Tonic, one of the things that he talked about was the fact that a community without a memory gets sick. Mm. A transitory community will have high indicators of ill health. It will have high indicators, statistically proven high indicators of various types of illness. And so one of the jobs that he articulated for arts companies, however they work, whatever their focus is the ability to retain memory in a place. Mm. And I'm wondering, Arti, whether or not that pops up in your world at all.
Well, I don't know if it does pop up. I mean, I like the notion of fragments and conversations, because actually, if you've done any kind of verbatim theatre work, when you kind of listen back to everyone who's spoken, it's actually very fragmented. Mm. There's never clear stories. And actually, if we were to just put exactly what people said up on stage, the audiences would say, actually, that doesn't make sense. It seems to be the way that we as human beings kind of converse with each other. We'll kind of have one thought, and then another thought will interrupt it, and so on and so on and so forth. In terms of... I'd like to just pick up on like what you're saying, like loss of memory in a way. There is that. When I was doing the Winston Churchill a couple of years ago, and I was looking into what areas, I looked into aging, dementia, and spirituality. And in the end, after a little bit of kind of thinking about it, I decided I wanted to look at generational memory loss. Because I thought, actually, here in the West, we're very, very obsessed with personal memory loss. And I wanted to start looking at what does it mean to have generational memory loss. So that was triggered off by the fact that I'd gone back to East Africa and found that actually because of disease and war, there's been a generation that's disappeared. And how did they pass on memory? What happened there? Then I started thinking a little bit more about the places I wanted to go to, and I decided I wanted to go back to actually see Aboriginal peoples. So in Australia, that's who I tried to get in touch with, and then also in America, which I didn't succeed in, with Native Americans. But it was interesting going back to meet some of the Aboriginal people. And I didn't meet pure blood Aboriginal people. I met people who had been who've now got a lot of mixed blood in them. And actually, they were at a point where they hadn't even been told that they had Aboriginal blood, and they were only just discovering it in their 50s onwards. At that time, they would have get taken away, and they would have, you know, would have had awful, dreadful lives. So it was interesting talking to them and watching them and how they were kind of reinventing culture, reinventing their traditions, reinventing their lives. Even the artists, the current artists there, are beginning to do that. So no longer it might be the dot painting. It was so I think it's fascinating. It's interesting. There may be sickness, but actually from there something else happens. There's another creative burst that happens, and another kind of beginning happens actually, because we have to carry on surviving and living. I would say that's certainly what I've done. My parents, the family came from India, went to East Africa, and now are here. that's a lot of movement. I don't know to this day where home is, actually. I expect it's London now. But there's a lot of things that make me up. And I would imagine that's true of a lot of us in this room as well, that there's a lot of mixed stuff going on in our backgrounds. So, yeah. I don't know if that made any sense in terms of memory and memory loss, but...
There's nodding. It makes sense to some people. Some people some of the time. And it's interesting because it's also one of the things... One of the reasons I got interested in working with older people was because I'm interested in what connects and what doesn't connect. And I'm interested in how art influences a wider culture. And because of that, I was looking at significant levers. And the fact that there is a massively aging population is such a significant changer. It's equal to climate change. It's incredibly important. And so once you start to say, well, actually, the sheer size of the population is going to change the culture that we live in, you start looking at two things. You start looking at the art that changes and the cultural institutions that hold a much longer narrative. So places like yours, which I said was 600 years old, which is ridiculous, 200 years old, but it's got 600 people who have this constant conversation about what it is. And it moves at a different kind of pace. So, and it's not reliant on Arts Council funding, so it doesn't go through funding cycles. And that makes it a very different and valued institution. And the interplay, the friction, if you will, between the artists that make and the institutions that hold is an incredibly rich, valuable culture to be in. We've got about another 15 minutes, so I want to open it out to you a little bit more and just take three or four thoughts and questions and observations that might be floating around out there in here and see whether we can address some of them in the last section. Age-appropriate material? Any others? Any?
I can only say that I did exactly the same thing. I took what I thought was the right generational music in to work with a group of older people. A terrific woman in her 90s from Stepney said, and bless her, she actually said, "Have you got the Rolling Stones?" So we did take the Rolling Stones in next week, which is my favourite group. And it's just that thing of being, it's person-centred. You know, you can take stuff in, but ultimately, week one, week two, and then week three might be totally different because then you know who's in the group and you start to respond to what you should be taking in. It is, you know, it's just... You've got to start somewhere, though, haven't you? Yeah. So you've got to think, I think, let's take that in. That's something from the 50s, something from the 60s, 70s, or whatever, and then see what they want to listen to or play.
Yeah. Over here.
I had a question about the artist and responsibility. And one would hope that in 50 years' time, people would look back at the society we live in now and think, my God, what shameful practice that was. And how as an artist do you, is there a dilemma between, if you're witnessing the way that we warehouse people in care homes, how do we avoid being complicit in those regimes? And when do we challenge? And when does our role change? And we need to go take, you know, the right up. So it's a question about responsibility and role of the artist in those places.
I could answer. Well, I can't answer that because I don't like it, but I. David knows I can't answer that, but I'll give it a go. I mean, I think that's an extremely difficult issue. And I will address it to two particular programs that Age Exchange has been involved in, which was very much about wanting to try and affect change within care homes, in these cases, National Health Service continuing care homes. So we went in with our package of Reminiscence Arts practice, trained practitioners, skilled artists, a lot of empathy, four of the six homes closed during the process of those 3 years. And as two of them were closing, you could actually not just see them closing, but you could see mismanagement and you could see the kind of loss of... we could see the staff really, really struggling mentally to come to terms with what was happening to them already on very low. Let's not forget this. Perhaps we should mention, you know, the real elephant in the room. And I know it's awful to say this, but artists, and I know, are not happy about what they're paid and don't feel valued a lot of the time. Most artists are paid probably 10 times an hour more than a carer, a professional carer in either a private care home or a local authority care home. And that's really a crucial difference. So in terms of trying to embed change or pass on or disseminate skills between the artists and the professional care staff, I think sometimes I, quite arrogant actually, in about thinking what else they should be able to take on. And perhaps thinking, we need to think perhaps a little bit more about how we can affect those places and change things within those places. I think we're quite naive about thinking that the answer is actually just what we do. It might not just be about what we do. And I think without spending more, certainly the big projects that we've been running, yes, they were. I thought they went really rather well, but we didn't spend anywhere near enough time. Next time we need to get the same amount of funding to be in the same place 5 days a week and not one. And that's, you know, I think that's, again, that's the privilege of the artist, isn't it? Going in and going out, you know, as opposed to staying there and being resident there. We, in a recent project, only observed two instances of behaviour directed at two of the residents with dementia, and that we highlighted both of those and reported both of those issues. So, yeah, I don't know if that doesn't... But it's very, very difficult because ultimately the warehouses that you talk about are not fit for purpose. They have barely grown out of a Victorian model of what my father was, a geriatric care, geriatric social work, that kind of model that was workhouse into those kind of homes, which is not even 100 years ago. But yeah, anyway, I'll stop.
Slightly different but related, and being a bit cheeky. But Mon, is the work that you do affecting the institution that you do it in? So I know when I talk to the department in Monroe, New York, that it's slowly beginning to change, but it's very difficult. It's really, really difficult because they say that. So, for instance, one of the ways that it's starting to change there is they began with a program where people would come into the gallery. And then they realised people couldn't come into the gallery anymore because it's physically difficult to get across Manhattan. And so that meant they had to think about what they could send out. And so now they have these groups, which are a bit like book clubs, which meet online. But to meet online, that meant they had to teach people how to go online. And so the Museum of Modern Art then ended up running training programmes or supporting training programmes for people who were interested in the paintings, but the mechanics of getting engaged were different. And so that sort of changed. There are... The embracing of older populations or people with Alzheimer's and dementia starts to shift in institution. I'm just wondering whether that's happening, whether you can see it. In some ways, it's very early days.
Yeah. So a program that's been running for 6 years in an institution that's 250 years old, I think I'd be kidding myself to think that we're making any fast-paced change. But I'd like to think so. I think one of the smaller ways that we're changing is our approach to ensuring that the people that are welcoming and facilitating someone's trip feel confident to be engaging with the breadth of people that might be coming through the doors, whether that's specifically for my program or not. So I'd like to think that that's a change. I'd like to think, well, it's a difficult question. I'd like to hope that there's a visibility element of it. And we spoke about this a little bit before. And I feel a bit sensitive talking about it because it happens across a lot of my programs that I've come to think that it's not only just about ensuring that people, a broad variety of people, feel welcomed and a sense of ownership over the work and the things that go on at the RA, but it's also becoming important to me that these things are visible, and whether that's someone seeing different people walking around the gallery spaces, or they just see the signage for a program and think, oh, didn't know the RA did that. That's a new facet. Just thought you did impressionist shows in the summer exhibition. Then I guess that there's a small shift in, I think most people that work at the RA in my department are constantly chipping at the edge of the Royal Academy being considered the incredibly elitist Royal Academy, and making it flex a little bit. And I think we're getting there. We just received Heritage Lottery Fund money for our big building extension, and that's got an activity plan attached to it. And it's a real, you know, it's a real shift for us. So, I mean, watch this space in the next few years, but there certainly seems to be a big investment in what I'm in doing. And I think that's partly because we're governed by living artists. Yeah. And a lot of those artists now that are governing our decisions are in older age themselves, are experiencing these things, and there's a natural curiosity there that I
It's that whole thing about what the institution holds and what the institution changes. And you know, the advantage of getting to be old is that you can see different waves of change working at different periods and processes. I mean, it's really interesting to begin the conversation talking about working with people who were, you know, born in the 1890s, Victorians, and now we work with people who were born in 1920s, 1930s, yeah. Very, very different people.
Very.
Very different life experiences, David was talking about last week. And so the relationship, because it's really, that's what we talked about all night, is the relationship between us. People, the people we're becoming changes constantly. We're getting near to the kind of last couple of minutes, and I'm really just wondering if there's any little bon mots, little small things to leave people with, to take on their bosses home.
Well, I don't know if it's going to be short, but you know, David, you raised a really interesting question about, you know, the artist and their responsibility. And I suppose for me, the short answer really is that I would rather be in there right now than not be in there. Is one, and absolutely, I personally will fight tooth and nail for the whole system not to become and remain medicalized. So I can do that on a very personal level. And in a kind of even personally at home, I'm actually even I don't know if I'm going to let you keep this on record actually, but I will say it to you as this audience. But even at home, there's gentle fights going on with the family to say actually let's not do the care home thing. Let's see if we can manage this care for our parents at home, and that means. Personal sacrifice. That means individual sacrifice for us as individuals, which we are going to have to absolutely weigh up. It's not just about the artist, but us as individuals that we are going to have to consider that. So I think it's a huge challenge, but we're only going to come to answers individually.
Can I just say, I'll just finish by saying one thing, if that's okay. so my last thing is that while we are quite critical in some ways of what we would call the clinical model, or the, you know, the dependence on the clinical model, I don't think we should forget that there is also excellence and ability and knowledge behind it. And I do think we really do need to think about the issue of how artists are prepared professionally and trained to work with people with dementia. And that is a really crucial issue. And I think in many places it's quite ad hoc. And I know for my own organization, we've tried really, really hard to set up a diploma in reminiscence arts practice and have failed for all kinds of reasons. But it's the next stage to, I do think there needs to be taking on board all these different ways of working with people with dementia. I would like to think that my daughter could go somewhere and capture and learn from that collective knowledge in order that she could go and in 20 years' time work in the kind of places that we're working in today.
I would completely agree with that idea of a responsibility of the artist educators that are engaging in this practice, but also the managers and the institutions that that can track them. And I work with four that have been running it with me since the beginning, and we think a lot about training that they might need. Sometimes that changes. We try and learn together, and it has become an increasing concern of mine that things are springing up at different institutions across London, across the UK. Different people working on these projects, varying amounts of research, varying amounts of training. And I think there needs to be a conversation about what the responsibilities are for an institution like mine when we start working in this world. And it's happening more and more, and not just in people creatively engaging with people experiencing dementia, but other audiences who are engaged in the healthcare system for whatever reason. And I think it's a bit of a worry of mine
Can I just add one little
observation? And I know it's a worry of Hannah's as well.
Yeah.
So talking about all of this really is over the last few weeks, having taken the garden into various places, one of the consistent responses has been, you've really thought about this, haven't you?
You really have. So it's my job to kind of wrap it up. I'm not going to tie it nicely up with a bow because I don't think there's any point. It would be really interesting to come back to this if we're still alive in about 20 years' time and see what's changed. It is very interesting having been involved for about 20 years and see how it changes, because it does. And it partly changes because we get to play on the edge of what we know and what we don't. And thank you very much for spending an hour and a half playing on the edge of what we know and what we don't. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.